now entering
the Horror Sanctum.
Howdy, and welcome back to the Horror Sanctum podcast. I'm Jay with John, Kellen, and TJ. And this week, we're joined by producer Blake Babson. Blake, welcome to the Sanctum.
Thank you for having me. Flattered. Yep.
Absolutely. We are also equally flattered. So you worked on several films and television series, including the Fright Night remake, House of Cards, and The Avengers. But today, we've asked you to select a film for us to chat about. And honestly, the film that we chose is one I've been looking for a reason to go back and revisit. It's 2015's The Invitation, which is available on Tubi. It's also available on Pluto TV, I believe. So if you haven't seen it, go watch it, come back. We'll wait for you. So if you're not familiar with the film, it follows Will while attending a dinner party at his former house. He soon starts to believe that his ex-wife and her new husband have sinister plans for their guests. Again, we don't want to give spoilers. It's not that old. But I do recommend you watch it and come back if you haven't already. So with that being said, let's take our seat at the dining room table and dig in.
So are we not giving spoilers the whole show or just not the upfront?
No, we always give spoilers.
Yeah, I know. I thought you were throwing.
I'm just warning the 2000 listeners and watchers that there will be spoilers. So they do have the option to go watch this movie for free and then come back and enjoy it with us together, or they can just listen.
Okay. Fair.
Have you not done the show before, TJ? Come on.
Yes, but you don't usually say that. So I was like, okay, that kills 2/3 of my content. So this might be a shorter show. Anyway, yeah, this film flew under my radar up until this past October. I noticed it started appearing on a lot of people's like best of list and like movies you probably haven't seen that you need to see. And it was streaming on Peacock. It's still, as of this recording, it's streaming on Peacock and several free services, including Freevee and Tubi. So it's very accessible, easy to watch for free. It's a very indie film. It's actually directed by the lady who directed Girl Fight, which was the movie that put Michelle Rodriguez kind of on the scene before, you know, the Fast and the Furious movies and all the, you know, insert tough girl roles that she's taken over the years. Her name is Karen Kusama. That was her first wrote and directed debut, the Girl Fight film. Actually, her husband of 18 years, Phil Hay, he and his writing partner have written a lot of kind of big budget Hollywood movies like Clash of the Titans, things like that. So he and his writing partner wrote The Invitation, and they produced it totally independently, low budget, shot it in LA, and they did that so they could have total control over the production without any studio interference. And I think that was a great idea for a small film like this, where it's mostly one location, low budget. It's a lot of people in a room. It's kind of talk heavy until that last kind of quarter, 20 minutes or so, where the action really, you know, it just builds to a crescendo. I don't know that, with having a big studio involved, if they would have gotten the leeway to be able to draw out for over an hour, about an hour, 15 minutes or so before really the shit hits the fan and all the actions, like, you know, it's all pretty condensed there in that last quarter. But man, this is one of the most uncomfortable films to watch just because of the social interactions, because we've all been to a party that we kind of felt like the odd man out or didn't quite know why we were here. And just imagine in the scene, and with just a little bit of information we get in that first scene in the car before they hit the coyote, and then that's a whole nother mess to try and go into a social situation after having to have just murdered a defenseless animal who you accidentally hit with the car out of its misery, mercifully.
I would have just gone home after that. Like, okay, this is, I'm going, I'm done. I'm out. I'm going
home. Yeah. Yeah. Like, I'm already going to this awkward party thrown by my ex-wife, who I haven't seen in 2 years, that our marriage ended tragically after the accidental death of our son. I mean, and also I haven't really seen any of these friends that were our collective friends. I mean, it seems like the worst possible scenario ever. And then you throw in, I have to murder this coyote unexpectedly about 5 minutes before. I'm like, yeah, I'm done. This would have been a very short film if I had been the protagonist. Never would have got to the party. But, you know, we have to see through the character of Will, the tension. I mean, he's very much the vehicle of which the audience gets to take this ride. And I was noticing, this is now the second time I watched it. I watched it in spooky season last year, and then I watched it a couple days ago. And I noticed much more so this viewing that he's not really a great boyfriend in this party. Like, he's almost never with his current girlfriend, who he's already taking into this terribly awkward situation, and just kind of doing his own thing. Randomly, he's always just walking through the house trying to look at his old house that he hadn't seen in a couple years and have PTSD memories and stuff while she's just trying to be, you know, good representative of the couple here with all his old friends, I'm sure, asking him lots of weird questions she doesn't know how to answer. And anyway, it becomes very clear, you know, about a quarter of the way into the movie why they've brought them here. They've joined this weird cult in Mexico, as you do when you're getting over, you know, a terrible loss or tragedy. And they found their will to live, or their joy, their bliss, whatever it is, and they want to share it with everyone. And of course, as most cult things do end, it doesn't end well. And man, just the way this movie ratchets up the tension and the awkwardness, I would say I would lead heavy with the awkward social interactions, because they put so much of it on Will, the main guy. Like, oh, you shouldn't feel weird about this. We're all just having fun here, you know? And then he thinks that his friend has been murdered because he gets that call. And of course, as in any of these isolated and in one location films, you can't have cell service until you go to the very edge of the property outside when you're being a weirdo again. And
which, in defense of the screenplay, is very accurate for Mulholland Drive and the Hills. It's actually a very true. It's one of the few times in a movie that's accurate.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, in the hills, and you got all the trees and all the things. I mean, it's one of those things where it definitely services the plot. But in all these modern films, I think you and I, Blake, have talked about this. You have to have a mechanism to cut people off from their technology now, or else it just doesn't make sense, because when you're one call away from 911, suddenly that isolated situation isn't so isolated anymore. So it's good that they can do it in a way that is accurate. But of course, he thinks that they've killed and stuffed away his friend who showed up early before everybody else. And then he comes in literally about 5 minutes before everybody really does realize that, oh no, he's just right. But they make him really feel like an asshole right before they start trying to kill everybody, which I think was just a expert 1-2 kind of punch. It's like you ratchet it up to where you think the big reveal is going to happen. Then you let all the wind out. And then when the wind's out, you give them that quick gut punch and be like, no, you were right. Too few films trust the writing, I think, enough to be able to kind of pull that off well and just let the audience down just enough to get them off track to then swerve them again, which I love. I love it when a film does that. But I think this lives kind of in that almost that mumble gore kind of Adam Wingard, The Guest, You're Next, but not a slashery, you know, somewhere in that kind of category. It's got that where it's mostly the horror is in the relationships and the people and the awkward interactions and the being stuck in this space with these people who are weird, and then you get strangers who are weird, and you have to kind of deal with those people, and you're just layering up the tension and the awkwardness, and then you add horror elements on top of that, and then chef's kiss. It's just a great, it's a great fun time. I love the ending, because it hints at, without having to really show it or have much production value to get the point across, to end with the fact that, oh, they've been signaling this is a coordinated effort by a much larger cult. And there's a lot of people out in Hollywood Hills that are having some bad parties this evening. And to just end with the sounds of, you know, police and sirens and chaos going off, and to see all those red lamps lighting up the hills, which the main antagonist had just done recently to kind of signal that this was happening. Man, I could probably watch this movie every year because it's just so expertly done. But Blake, this was one of the ones that you chose to bring to us. So tell us what your relationship is with this film, how you got turned on to it.
Yeah, I missed it when it originally came out. This was a quarantine film for me, you know, sitting around the house trying to find something fun to watch. And I don't usually jump on films that I can kind of feel like I might be able to predict, right? One house, okay, something goes wrong. So I almost put it on like as an eye roll, saying this might entertain me for an hour and a half. And then what I love about the movie is I love efficient scripts. I love scripts and films that do a lot with very little, which I think this film does perfectly. But I also love it because it's also very specific to people who, not just the social awkward element of going to a dinner party you don't want to go to, but if you lived in LA, I lived in LA for 13 years, you've been to parties like this, maybe not where a cult is introduced at the midpoint, but where you might know some people through other people and they're a little strange and you kind of want to leave, because the real monster in this movie is like the group dynamic, right? Because whenever someone would talk to me about this film and say, oh, I would have left, I always tell them, don't be so sure. You know, group pressure, peer pressure is a really powerful thing. There's been about 100 years of studies to prove that people will kind of stick around longer than they should in bad situations. And I think this film, like you were saying, TJ, every time you think he should be leaving now, there's another reason why maybe he thinks he should stay, right? They give you another little stone to follow. And I would argue that they don't really even need, watching it a second time, they don't really need the gimmick of the phone service being out, because they never really use it. By the time a character says, I'm calling the police, that's at the point where things are about to pop off anyway. So they actually could have gotten away with never even using it as a gimmick. I think they used it just to kind of make the audience feel better. But honestly, everything is paced so well in this film, you never go, that's unrealistic, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, this film, for me, I locked in at the point, you know, obviously there's that awkward tension that you're talking about, which is just uncomfortable. It's like a really long episode of Nathan for You or something, right? Where it just keeps pushing the envelope of awkwardness and you know, the character, is it Sadie? Like the weird character it's kind of comes from nowhere. And you see her kind of in silhouette at first.
She's almost like a Manson girl. Like
exactly. Kind of. Yeah, that's, I think you were 100% spot. That's a little nod to the Manson family.
Overly sexualized.
Exactly. Yeah. She is so good. She, on second rewatch, might be my favorite character, only because without her, it's just some kind of normal people who might have some issues. With her added, you immediately believe the cult. I feel like you believe that this person could have been sucked in by this. So that makes everyone else kind of believable after that point. But the anchor of the film, I think, is John Carroll Lynch in Pruitt. I think for me, the moment he walks into the house, I was in. I was already liking the tension, but when Pruitt walks in and the power he holds, the size of John Carroll Lynch, he does it very well in Zodiac as well. If you've ever seen Zodiac, he's the potential real killer in that film. He's able to carry that. Every mood in that film is carried by him so well. And I think he actually kind of saves it, because I think if you didn't have a good kind of personification of the danger then the film would have gotten a little silly, I think, at some point.
I agree. Kill and I were texting back and forth about him. He's phenomenal and everything, and he plays creepy to perfection. Like anything he's ever been in where he played that type of character. And yeah, I agree. Bringing him in is kind of like almost an enforcer type.
Yeah.
In this situation did save the film a lot.
It did.
He's a physical. That was one of the things I was going to talk about too, is he's just so fantastic. He's one of my favorite character actors that doesn't get the credit he deserves.
Yep. He shows up and hits home runs whenever he's on screen. And he also has a monologue that also didn't hit me as much as it did the second time, where he describes he's trying to get
killing sympathy. His wife.
Yeah. He's trying to get sympathy by telling a story of him essentially getting drunk and beating his wife to death. And he almost pulls it off, by the way. It's such a good monologue. It's such a good performance that you kind of start to think, oh, maybe he is this reformed guy, until everyone's reaction is, well, no, you just told a story about you murdering your wife, and we don't really care if you went to prison. You really shouldn't be here.
After they just showed a video of watching someone die while everyone breathes in her spirit.
Right, right, exactly. And that, like I said, the moment he enters, I was sold. The moment, again, the director, she really knew how far. Again, another reason why I wanted to talk about the film is she knew how far to take each scene and how to extend the tension enough without ever becoming gratuitous. When Claire, the character, again, brilliant writing point. It's fine. I'm the screenwriter in me loves the screenwriter knew we need someone to leave now or want to leave. Right. This is getting so silly that the sane person here needs to leave. So Claire gets up, says, you know what, I'm not feeling well. I'm going to go home. And you just see Pruitt follow her out to her car. Oh, are you the Prius? I parked behind you. Let me just pull out. And you see him flag her down. They go around the corner and then they don't show anything. They distract you again. So you're constantly given another breadcrumb that's just enough to wet your palate to continue down this sick road that they're making.
And I don't know if anybody else noticed, but he came back with a coat on his arm.
I didn't notice that.
But it wasn't the coat she was wearing. So I don't know if that was supposed to mean anything or not. Interesting. But when I watched it again, I'm like, he has a coat, but I rewound it. It's not the same coat. I wished it was, because that would just be like a little subtle nod to what we, you know, assume happened anyways.
My last point I want to talk about, which I think, Jay, you said you had something to talk about. Again, watching it a second time, the film chooses to show our main characters, you know, hit a coyote on their way up to the party. Not only is it a nice little jump scare that, again, isn't gratuitous because it happens, especially up in those hills, they hit this coyote and they put it out of their misery. That is such a great way to immediately set a tone and to immediately focus your audience and make them feel like, well, if that can happen, what else can happen? And it's done literally, I think, before the 60-second mark of the film starting. It is done almost immediately. And that, again, that's like, that shows a director that's aware that she has to kind of grab her audience and let them know where this is headed. I think it's done just perfectly, all very just pitch perfect.
And in a film that's made to be a slow build, you almost have to have that.
Exactly. Yep. Yep.
Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
No, that was that. Yeah. Continue.
Yeah, I kind of watched this today, and I think I'd seen clips of it before. I didn't really know what to expect. It's one of those films to where if I just look at the images of it, I'm going to first think this is probably overrated just from the image, because a lot of these type of films are, like, when you think, like, what's the big deal? I really liked it, though. Watched it, was really surprised by it. Everything was done really well in it. The tension, the building, the characters. Even from the start, like everyone said, you know, the coyote gets run over and it's foreboding, right? There's something to come. And you just feel so bad about Will, just because, you know, he's in this house and he's kind of reliving this trauma and this PTSD, and he's walking around and he is snooping around a lot. Like, but I really felt bad for him because he's kind of like has these memories of this house and the kid. And that's kind of a good reason that, you know, he wouldn't leave, is I think there's something there that's just drawing him back into it. And I just think, you know, something like that, it's a very odd situation for anyone to go through. So I can understand, like, that's really a weird place to be in mentally, especially when you see your wife, your ex-wife with a new husband, and you can see he's kind of full of shit. And then you can see your now ex-wife is kind of full of shit, which you can clearly see from, like, the first moments with her on screen. She's crazy. Like, she slaps the friend, and she's got this smiley bullshit aura around her.
It's a great performance. It's a great performance.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's like classic cult, right? That kind of stuff. And that's kind of what cults do, though, is they draw you in. They make you feel like you need something that they have. And, like, what you were talking about earlier, TJ, the big fake out, you know, when you overreact, they're just like, it's okay, we love you. Like, that's what they do. And that's kind of what they do until they overreact. And then by the time they overreact, it's too late. You're either dead or part of it, right? That's unfortunately just indoctrination with cults. It's like, it's scary, right? It's terrifying to think about, but it's happened with Jonestown. It's happened for years and years with all these different cults. It's how they get you, right? Yeah, it was interesting when I first saw, John Carroll Lynch show up. That was the first thing I thought. Was I was like, oh boy, this guy. I'm like the Zodiac Killer. Because I think that movie makes a good argument about Arthur Lee Allen, right? I know that there's real life evidence against it, but right when I saw him, I was like, holy crap. And then when he does that speech where he's talking about his wife, you know, him killing his wife. Like, if I was in that group, I think that's the point where I would just be like, I would be like, I'm sorry, I just shit my pants, I have to go to the bathroom. Like, I'd figure out a reason just to get out of there. But I also understand that whole thing, which you're talking about, like the indoctrination and the idea of social pressure, where you're in a situation, you want to be nice. Like, a society, we're taught, and even says it in the movie. He says, why is everyone being so nice? And I find that fascinating. Because he's one of the only characters in the movie besides Eden who's been through something so traumatic like that, that it's almost like he doesn't have fear. He's willing to go against this because he's faced something far worse than death. He's faced his own child's death. So it's like, at that point, your mind, you kind of, it's like he's really prepared for that in a way. And I thought it was interesting that he's the one that's like saying, you know, why is everyone being so nice? This is fucking weird, this whole thing. But I just thought, you know, the execution was really well done. I thought it was interesting when early on, when they open the door and he relocks the door and Will is talking to David and he's like, why don't you leave the key in? And he's like, oh, we got a lot of home invasions. But he could have left the key in because if it's locked, you still can't get in from the outside. But if it's locked from the inside, you can't get out of that door, right? So that was kind of another foreboding, like, what are you up to? What are you doing, right? The only thing about the movie that does not work for me on any level is the ending. I found that ending to be so stupid. Just because that, I get it's a cool thing to put in a film. I understand as a screenwriter, you put that in a film and you're like, oh shit, that's one of those moments at the end where you're like, it's happening everywhere. It's kind of dumb. It's kind of dumb. Like, that's not realistic. That doesn't.
It's fun dumb, though, John.
But it goes against the whole story, right? I mean, you're taking this story and you're making it into something. So it would have been, and I understand it would have been anticlimactic if it was just isolated, but realistically, it would have been isolated. I mean,
what's more terrifying? Like, the fact that it was just an isolated incident? Like, was your problem the lanterns in general, or just how many there were?
I just think it's the idea that they turn it into like the Purge, but with cults. I'm like, that's kind of stupid. Like, yeah, that's not right. Because my whole
you're kind of stupid.
Well, that is, I am in fact kind of stupid sometimes. I won't disagree there.
We all are.
But you know, like, I think it's just with any film, I think when you're taken on a journey, you have to like take it within the context of the story. So within a movie like this, you're in a reality based scenario. So when you get to the end and they hit you with something like that, you're just kind of like, but, you know, like, it'd be one thing if it was like a little more fantastical, if it was like you're next, like what you're talking about, where it's a little more ridiculous, you can do that. But that's the only negative I have on this movie. I mean, everything else is just really stellar, great acting. The suspense is great. There's really nothing I can pick apart about it other than that ending. So yeah, I'm curious to see what you guys think.
So I'm going to get to the ending towards the end of my part. And then I'm going to, crap on everything John said because he's a big dumb idiot. but y'all touched on a lot of the psychological parts. So I'm just going to kind of pick apart the movie, just from a idiot myself who didn't look into the deeper meaning of anything. I do agree that they did a really good job with the cult, being able to attract people, because that's what they prey on. Everybody that was part of the cult were grieving. They had something that had happened to them that they didn't have an answer for, and this guy's providing an answer. And that's how a lot of cults get you, is you don't have the answer, we have the answer for you. Yeah. Just come with us and we'll help you feel better, we'll help you push that pain away, and it's a community of healing. And Will is kind of the skeptic, right? Like, he's grieving too, but he's grieving in a more visceral way. Like, and that's part of what infuriates him too, is seeing his ex-wife almost be completely numb to the fact that they lost a child. And you know, I have two daughters, and if one of them was to die, I can't imagine how long it would take to get over that loss. I don't know that you ever could. And so you can see his frustration and anger at both of them for just pretending like sadness doesn't exist, like pain isn't real. Like, there's just a quick fix that all you got to do is breathe in the aura of some dead person, and all of a sudden, you know, all your pain goes away. It just, and like I said, that's how they get you, that this false promise of everything's going to be okay. And it's usually some psychopath that's going to kill everybody anyway. So, we touched on John Carroll Lynch. He's brilliant. I remember him all the way back in the Drew Carey Show days. He was in The Walking Dead, American Horror Story, Shutter Island. He's one of those people, you probably don't know his name, but you have seen him in something, and he has been fantastic in that something. Like I said, he's one of those character actors that when he comes on screen, you know that you're in for something. Even in the part of the movie where he's doing his monologue, basically telling his truth, he comes across, he increases the tension of this movie, which doesn't let up from the moment they hit that coyote and he has to put it down. This movie does something so similar to The Silence of the Lambs. That's what I kept thinking while watching this. I can't think of another movie in my mind that keeps you uneasy for the entirety. And that's kind of what this movie does, is you don't know what's going to happen. You have a sense, you have an idea, and your idea ends up being correct, you know, because you kind of go into it knowing that something's going to happen. And then the further it goes, you know that something bad's going to happen. But even without doing
movies that do that, we'll make you a list of movies that make.
No, I'm just saying, like, I can't think of any in recent memory, like just ones that we've watched recently, that does that so well, that keeps you. I don't know how to put it. You just feel off the whole movie. You feel like, Will, there's something off. I can't put my finger on it. I have an idea.
Gonna drop, kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. And then like said, when it starts to happen, but it doesn't, and then it does happen, and then you're just like, I really also, the one part that took me out, and it's a personal thing, and since we're all about the same age, you might have the same sense. Toby Huss will always be Artie, the strongest man in the world to me, and it doesn't matter what role he plays ever.
Wow.
Every time I see him, I always just think of him moving a house a half inch just far enough when the guy tries to open the door, his key hits the doorknob instead of the...
Yeah, Pete will always be his only accomplishment.
He's the Wiz, and nobody beats him. And
he's also the Wiz, that's true. Yeah.
There you go.
Like he's said, also movie... peanut butter on the penis guy and the Halloween 2018.
Yeah. I don't remember that, but I also tried to block that franchise out of my mind. So, but like I said, the movie's predictable, but it's not predictable in a way that leaves you disappointed. The biggest twist, obviously, is the ending. And to argue John's point, I feel like, and that very similarly mirrored Fight Club, right? The ending of Fight Club, when he's shot, he reaches over, holds her hand, looks over the landscape as all hell's breaking loose. So I thought that was a neat visual. What I will say is, in the modern era, it would make more sense than to try to congregate a bunch of people together to try to pull people into your cult digitally. They show that when they're showing the video on the computer of you know, their mantra. They're kind of explaining the, you know, vaguely, vague enough to where it might pull your interest in. So I could see a situation where this is all choreographed online in a digital sphere, where these people across, almost like it, like a purge, where all of these people across, you know, maybe even just that area, but maybe larger. It could have been, you know, beyond just their city. But I could see how, especially with everything sucking now, how easy it would be for people to be. I mean, look at all the televangelists that get millions and millions of dollars sent every year without question. I mean, one of the richest televangelists in the world, what's his face, looks like the definition of a snake oil salesman. That was blowing COVID away. Kenneth Copeland, he's worth like almost like $250 million shy of $1 billion, and people still send him money. So I could see somebody with enough charisma or enough likability pulling people in and causing a catastrophe on that kind of scale, where they look out and they just see more red lanterns. And I liked the hint to it earlier too. It just shows it. There's nothing spoken about. There's no, other than Will kind of like, what's he doing? He lights that lantern, and it's, you know, the signal that, you know, it's the beginning of the end. So I was pleasantly surprised with this movie. It also moved so quick. Like, when I was watching it, I checked the time and I was an hour in, and it felt like I had been watching it for 20 minutes, because it's just, and not a lot happens. That's so rare, where you have a movie where there's not a whole lot going on outside of dialogue, but it moves along so well. So this movie did exactly what it wanted to do, and it did it very well. Thoroughly enjoyed it. And I know Jay liked it, not to give away spoilers, but I'll pass it to him to bring us home.
I honestly hated it. like I said in the opening, like I was looking for a reason to watch this film again. I have a lot of sporadic notes, and I want to focus mainly on the coyote. But my other notes were like, first of all, I'm Will at any party. I'm checking the medicine cabinet when I'm going to the bathroom. I'm suspicious of everyone who's too nice or smiling too much. I'm constantly checking the exits to know where they are. Like, that's me. And like I said, if I hit that coyote in the beginning, I'm turning around going home, because the night's already screwed for me. But the first time I watched it, like I said earlier, it was just one of those, and I don't know if I said this before we start recording or not, but it's one of those films I had zero expectations for. And then after I watched it, I wanted everybody else I know to watch it. That was the impact it had on me. And just because the atmosphere and the tension and the score, like the whole time, like it's paced so well. And the whole time you have that pit in your stomach, and that, Kellen, touching on that, where you couldn't think of recent memory of movies that made you feel that way. A lot of the A24 horror movies are kind of that way. I think as a society, we're moving away from jump scares and slashers, and we're getting more of that. This movie makes me uncomfortable, like Human Centipede uncomfortable, you know, like you're still watching it. You can't take your eyes off of it, but you're not scared. You just have that pit in your stomach, and there's a pit in your stomach from the jump in this movie.
It's like it's like you want to look away, but you can't.
Right. The boyfriend, Michael Huseman is his name. I fucking hate that dude and anything he's ever been in. I can't stand him. So as soon as you see him, like, he's going to do something shitty. Like, you know, it's coming.
He is the definition of a resting schmarmy face.
Yes. Like, I don't know what it is about him. I cannot stand him. John Carroll Lynch. Perfect. Always perfect. I didn't even click the guy played Artie. I know him most from Carnival, the HBO series that lasted 2 seasons. He was Stumpy. And I've just seen that show so many times. When I think of him, that's the show I think of.
You know, he also did the voice of Khan on King of the Hill.
I didn't know that.
Korean yeah. neighbor.
But again, like, if I'm going to this party, I'm that SpongeBob meme where he's like, all right, I'm going to head out. That's me from the get-go. Touch about the key and the door. There's the scene where David answers the door. Like, someone knocks on the door. We never see who it is. We don't understand what they're saying. So I think that kind of ties into the lanterns at the end. It's someone who's in the cult. They're like, hey, when's this shit going down? What time? You know, I don't know, remember what he says, but something along the lines like, you know, play it by ear, or you know when, blah, blah, blah. In my notes, it completely contradicts John. I put that the lantern scene was truly terrifying. I compared it in my head. I can't think of the movie, but it's a post-apocalyptic movie that's pretty recent in the last 5 years, but the opening scene is all these planes coming over the school as children are letting out, and this black dust just like flies over everything, and that's what starts this apocalypse. That was one of the scariest things I've ever seen in a movie, because it's something that can truly happen. And that's what I kind of trace this back to. It's like, oh, the Domestics, that's the film. If you've never seen it, great little film. It's got the guy who just played Superman in the Lois and Clark series, and Blonde that was in Blue Crush. I can't think of her name. But anyway, it's a good movie. But that was just terrifying to me when that happened, because you knew something was up when David put the lantern out. Anyways, you know, it just wasn't for funsies. Like, I'm just, you know, build the atmosphere, like, look out. He purposely looks out, and you know in your gut there's something else going on here. Now, the first time I watched it, I wasn't expecting that at all. I wasn't expecting to see, you know, dozens of lanterns across the hillside. But to me, that truly creeped me out the first time I watched it. There are also a lot of Christian and religious parallels in the film. I don't know if anybody else caught it. There's the part where they're all going upstairs to have dinner. They're ascending, you know, like, all he shows their feet going up. And then even when they're all sitting there, it's parallel to the Last Supper, with Will as Jesus, I guess. But
well, another thing there too, that could be a parallel is after Jesus died, which is the only son who died, their only son died. Yeah. Well, what did all the disciples do? They go into the upper room of this place and they're supposed to wait, which is kind of what this whole movie is. They're waiting exactly for the thing to happen.
Yeah. But as far as like little pieces, that's it. I love the film. I loved it the first time. I loved it more this time because, and that's the beauty, and I've said it on other episodes, the beauty of us going back and rewatching some of these films is the opportunity to catch things we didn't see initially, or we didn't think about initially, or after I watched it again, I'm like, I'm going to Google some things. For example, this whole next segment is all about coyotes. You know me well enough. You know that I'd rather see people die 1,000 times over on TV and movies than animals. So the coyote thing, I always take half a star on my ratings whenever an animal dies, which is why Cannibal Holocaust has 0 stars, -10 stars if I could give it. But the first time I watched, I'm like, damn it, coyote, like, that's sad. That's all I thought about it. The second time, I'm like, that represents something. So you'll forgive me for, I'm going to be reading a lot of this from paper because there's no way I can remember it all, but I Googled the significance of coyotes.
This segment brought to you by Acme, the hater of Wile E. Coyote.
Off the tracks here, but you see, like, Warner Brothers made a Wile E. Coyote versus Acme movie and no one's picking it up. So they're just going to fucking destroy it. Like, it makes no sense. Like, just put it out. Anyways. Again, I'm going to be reading this, so I do apologize. I'll be looking down a lot. But this was just something that the first thing I grabbed was like, there's something to this coyote. And I just wanted to do a little research on it. So a coyote is a symbol of wisdom, cunning, and survivability. That last word is key, survivability. If you dream of killing a coyote, it means you're falling victim to the lies and deceits of others. Check. Instead of believing them, seek to find the truth. Don't let them prey on your vulnerability. Check, check. So that falls right in line, and I didn't read anything from the director or the writers, but that's 100% what they were, you know, trying to push forward. Killing a coyote in a dream is symbolic of a change in your life. Obviously, a big change came. Killing a coyote represents overcoming obstacles or a desire to control over a difficult situation. check, check, check. Like, it's just checking all these boxes of Will. Like, he knows something's up. So he's looking around. He's snooping. He's keeping his eye on everybody. The emotions of killing coyotes in your dreams. So if feeling strong and successful in your dream that you kill this coyote can indicate that in your waking life, you'll be faced with a challenge that you will overcome, which Will did overcome. On the other hand, if you feel sadness, guilt, or regret, like moi, it can indicate your regret in decisions or actions, which also check that box. Overall, a dream about a killed coyote can indicate an upcoming change that one will successfully master. It can also mean that you will let go of old behaviors and habits and embark on a new path. So it just blew my mind, all the parallels.
That's it. I'm coyote. In. Where's the Kool-Aid? Give me the Kool-Aid. I'm in.
Kool-Aid. My Band of Horses beer. But
that was actually Flavor-Aid that they drank. They couldn't afford Kool-Aid.
So I also
they weren't read, cool enough.
I also read that the coyote, killing the coyote and how he felt kind of represents the four cultists in their current state and how they're currently feeling. They're in deep pain. They want to be free. It foreshadows Will's emotionally killing of his ex-wife after she requests him to do it at the end of the film. So that, I don't remember what I gave this initially, like rating wise out of 5. It was probably a 3.5 or a 4. But spoiler, we'll do our rankings here in a bit. But that alone, like just doing that little bit of research and seeing the dots getting connected like that, just boosted it up big time for me and made me enjoy this movie so much more than I did originally. So that's that. That's my whole fucking sheet on coyotes. Wow.
Well, it really made me appreciate it more. So thanks for doing that research.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like I've told Kellen before, I don't remember what movie it was. It might have been Beyond the Black Rainbow or some other heavy movie. Like sometimes these movies that make you think, it definitely benefits to just take some time and Google it. Even if you Google something simple as like today I did a Zone of Interest ending explained, just to get a little bit more background on what was happening. That always helps. That's what I did here. Like, I want to know the symbolism and I want to know all these emotions and everything. So
after I watched Donnie Darko for the first time 20 something years ago and the early mm-hmm. days of the internet, I went on a deep 3-day rabbit hole.
Oh yeah.
Message.
I was about to say that movie was horrible for the early days of the internet. You know horrible. How hard it was to try to understand
yes,
what happened.
I watched I do.
It 3 times
I did
in
it.
One day.
I thought you were saying Donnie Darko was horrible and I was about to end this fucking friendship real quick.
No, that spoiler, if we ever cover it, that's a 5-star movie for me.
Yes, it is. Did anyone else see the sequel?
No.
S Darko. Terrible. No. Fucking terrible. Anyways, if anyone else have anything to add before we get around to our
I had something that I didn't notice the first time that I just think is interesting because it breaks convention. At the crescendo third act moment of insanity, the first person to draw blood is Will. He
pushes the girl.
He actually essentially kills a person at the time. He's a 99% certain something's going on, but he's not 100% yet. And he essentially kills Sadie.
It was self-defense though, right?
It was self-defense, but I found it really interesting that
she comes back later.
She does, right? Yeah. Yeah, she does. But what an interesting script choice to have Will be the one who draws blood first, which is a little unconventional for a film like this. You would think it would be the gunshot, the, you know, Pruitt character, whatever. I found that kind of an interesting choice. It didn't need to happen that way.
And in that scene, that's kind of a brilliant red herring because they show the only person to drink they go around. You see her throw the drink back. And then before you can process, because your mind's immediately going to go to something like, you know, Heaven's Gate where, okay, this is how they're going to kill them. And then that happens. And it's so alarming. It completely takes you out of the fact that, oh, she's about to die.
Yep.
Because you knew that when she drank it, but then you're immediately pulled out of that mindset because you're like, oh my God, he just killed that girl.
Yep.
Thing I didn't notice until the second time I watched it was the whole first part of the film, they're drinking wine. All in their living room.
That was in my notes too. They're conditioning them to drink the wine to get their guard down.
But on the first part of the movie, it's always out of bottles and you see them open the bottles, but it's out of this decanter when it's this final scene.
Mm-hmm.
The Sadie character was great too in that one scene where she was making the faces in the mirror. That I think that was just her, like, what am I going to look like when I die? Like, yeah, being dramatic, yeah. Like making all those faces. Like, what face do I want to make when I move on to the other side? She was a great character. All right, so Blake, we're going to go around and give our ratings. We give what we think this movie is out of 5 stars. We'll start with, we'll just go in the order in which we talked. So we'll go TJ. What would you give this one?
Yeah, this is one of the rare movies that actually goes up with rewatches for me. I probably would have gave this somewhere around a 3.5, maybe a 4 the first time I watched it, but I just keep seeing new nuances and new things to like about it, and I'm sure I'll probably find more. So right now I'm at a 4.5. I love this movie.
All right, Blake?
Yeah, I'm right there. 4.5 out of 5 for me. I want to give it a perfect score, but I also don't want to be, for anyone who watches On Cinema, I don't want to be the guy who gives five out of fives all the time. No, it's about as perfect as you can get, especially for a film with no budget, a simple location, one, you know, very thin, efficient script. I think it's about as good as you can get as far as a fun, quick horror film.
Yeah, John.
Well, here comes the fun ruiner. Wah, wah, wah. I was going to address a couple things. So you're talking about Fight Club killing. I love Fight Club, one of my favorite films ever. I would argue that because the similarities, because Fight Club is very surreal, very insane. Like, there's nothing about Fight Club that's practical. By the end of that movie, that ending is so fitting because there's nothing in that film that exists in a real world scenario. This film,
I just meant from a visual perspective.
Well, yeah, holding
hands, sure. And staring off as the world burns.
We're not even supposed to be talking about it.
Guys. Sure.
We're not even supposed to be talking about it.
Yeah, exactly. That's true. Yeah. So I just think with the ending for me, like a lot of times with movies, when they do something this straight laced and they have a story that's straight, they do these cinematic holy shit moments. And it's really cool for the moment, but like, it just, my opinion, like it just kind of takes me out of it because it's almost like they're taking me down one road and they're like, whoop. And I'm like, that doesn't really line up with the script writing, but it's just my take. I know a lot of
people could also look at it as it just showing just how many people are in that mental state, in that hurting, you know, people.
Yeah.
Think about, it's kind of showing the grandeur of how many people are suffering in the world.
Yeah, I don't know. I just go along with, like, it always fits the script, and this is one of those things where it just took me out of it. But, you know, you were talking about A24. I do think there's a lot of good A24. I think there's a lot of mediocre A24 that's way overrated, but that's just kind of what's happening in our society now.
Looking at you, talk to me.
Yeah, exactly. Talk to
me. I liked it. Not great, but
you would.
But that being said, I think it's a really good film. It'd probably be a 3.5 out of 5. I don't think it's like, there's nothing about it to me that's like a legendary film, like a top 20 or anything. So that's why I keep the review a little bit lower. But 3.5, I mean, I would almost lean closer to a 4, but I'd say 3.5. I mean, it's really good.
I challenge you to watch it again, John, because that's exactly where I was after watching it in October.
Here's the thing, though. One thing I don't believe in is I don't believe in watching a film, being underwhelmed by it, and then rewatching it and being impressed, because I find it's fine.
It happened to me.
It's fine to find things about a film that are interesting later, but I find if something doesn't immediately grab you first watch, like, I don't believe in that whole, like, I have to think about it later more to give it a higher rating. I never believe
that's
in that.
What if Kellen agrees to rewatch Creepshow?
Well, he's already, he doesn't get a second chance. He's already crapped on
it. Not my fault you like turds, John.
Oh.
All right, Kellen, what would you give it?
For a movie that telegraphs and foreshadows exactly what's going to happen, it does it so well that you enjoy the journey. You know your destination is, you know, everyone's going to die, or most of everybody's about to die in this house. But the journey getting there is so, so well done that you don't care that you know what's going to happen. So for that reason, the acting's fantastic. The way it's shot, the cinematography is brilliant, considering they're using such a limited set. I give it a 4. Yeah. Solid 4 film.
One of my biggest things about movies and not giving five stars or close to it is the rewatchability. And this is one of those movies that shouldn't be one that has a high amount of rewatchability, because once you see it, it's done. Like, you know what's going to happen. But again, watching again, you catch all these little things. And I want to share it with other people. I want other people to watch it because it impacted me. So I gave it a 4.52. Again, I think originally I gave it a 3.5 or a 4. But after watching again, which I do think, John, you should watch it again without any distractions. And Kellen, watch Creepshow again. But that puts us at a 4.2. So that give us a 4 for The Invitation. I think that's beyond fair. Again, TJ, you said it was on Peacock. It's on Tubi and Pluto. You know, go watch it.
Some other
being a good headspace when you watch it, you know, don't go in it sad because you might join a fucking cult. But
I think the ending was it for me. If the ending was different, I would give it a 4 or 4.5. That's what gets it for me is the ending. I hate that ending.
I was thinking, like you said, it takes you down one road. I'm like, it does take you down a road, but instead of changing the roads, I think it just drops you off a cliff. You know?
Yeah, and I think that kind of movie's been done so much. I think it's hard to come up with a new original ending. Like, I think that's their new original ending. And, you know, for me it worked, for you it didn't. But I'm glad they took that swing.
Just turn it off a minute early, John, and then it's the John.
Like, because oh, I thought, look at that.
I thought the shmarmy guy was. I mean, obviously he was going to raise up from the dead and come at him one more time. Like, that's the predictability route.
Yeah, and that's the thing too about this movie is while you won't watch it 1,000 times, the whole time you know what's happening. You know, like, you're not unaware of the situation and what Will's gotten himself into, but still you feel it in your stomach, and you still have, even the second time, like, I knew how it ended. I knew the lanterns were going to, like, I knew everything, but I still watching it again, had that pit in my stomach the whole time. And that's something that a lot of films don't do for me anymore. Like, they give you those emotions, especially horror films. Like, they're few and far between that make you feel this way, and especially after knowing what you're getting yourself into. So, all right, Invitation, 2015, not to be confused with the one that came out, 2022, about vampires and shit?
Or the 2003 one with Lance Henriksen, where he invites a bunch of people to his house, and spoiler alert, doesn't...
Don't get confused. 2015, The Invitation. And the main dude that played Will, I can't think of his name. He's a great actor. I don't know if anyone else saw Upgrade. Upgrade was fantastic. Very under the radar.
Oh, that's him. Yeah, really that is good.
It's really good.
And he looks so much cooler with all that hair and beard. But anyways, 4 Invitation. So that's going to do it for this episode. Be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel or to wherever you're listening to this podcast. Follow us on Instagram. Follow us on TikTok. Join our Facebook group where we just talk about horror movies all day with like-minded individuals. And if you're feeling sad, join a cult. What do you have to lose? Blake, thank you again for joining us. It was a lot of fun. And thank you for choosing a movie that, for the most part, we all highly enjoyed.
Thank you for having me, guys. It was a pleasure. Thank you so much.
All right, so signing off, I'm Jay with Blake, John, Kellen, and TJ. And until next time.
Keep it spooky.
Believe in ghosts? I do. And you will too when you come to this theater and see my picture, 13 Ghosts. No more dictation today. When you see 13 Ghosts, you'll be given a supernatural viewer like this, which will enable you to penetrate for the first time into the spirit world. It will let you see all 13 of our weird, wonderful, and wildly assorted ghosts.
Now, brace yourself as we take you across the threshold of our haunted mansion, where there's a ghost for everyone in the family. Father, mother, sister, brother. You'll be scared stiff too when you see what they see. 13 ghosts materializing in ectoplasmic color through the magic of Illusiono, the ghost viewer. The ghost of a lion in the basement. The ghost of a murderous cook in the kitchen. ghost who speaks through the lips of the living.
Death tonight to one of you.
The evil ghost in the bedroom, fighting to take possession of this beautiful girl. You'll feel all the thrills and chills of seeing one ghost multiplied by the magic number 13.
Whitewood, Massachusetts. A young girl, a stranger, has come to Whitewood to do research. She has come, she thinks, to study.
Leave Whitewood. Leave Whitewood tonight, I beg of you. Leave before it is too late.
In spite of this warning, the girl lingers on. The guests are over 300 years old. Human blood keeps them alive forever.
Barlow.
Take it easy, Dracula. What do you think I'm carrying here, my dirty laundry?
Where a man-eating talking plant gives homicide something to think about.
And I didn't do it.
Do what?
Whatever.
Why are you so nervous?
Kisser.
Now you will do as I say.
Yes, Master.
You will go out and find me some food.
Yes, Master.
What's the matter? Don't you like me?
Too bony.
Too bony? Nobody ever told me that before.
Beef is better than veal.
Oh, you're such a dodo.
What do you call this? Chopped liver?
The children do not live with you?
No, they are at my country estate in Bligh. A rather large, rather lonely place.
Have they had a governess before?
Unfortunately. Not that there was anything wrong with Miss Jessel. She was an excellent governess and a most respectable woman.
I'm not certain that I understand you, sir.
And she died.
We've all been waiting and waiting for you to come. Oh, we have been excited.
So have I. I've been very excited indeed. I never imagined. Oh, I'm so sorry.
That's all right, miss. It's always happening.
And what an enchanting child she is.
She does like to wander, to go off by herself. We're always hunting her.
Oh, yes. I heard you. Just now, as I was coming through the garden, I heard you call her name.
Oh, not me, miss. Perhaps it was Anna or Cook.
Promise now, you won't go away.
I expect to be here for a very long time. What was she like?
Who, miss?
The other governess, the one who died.
Miss Kittens, mm-hmm. Where would the Lord take my soul to?
To heaven.
Are you certain?
Yes, of course, because you're a very, very good girl.
But I might not be, and if I weren't, wouldn't the Lord just leave me here to walk around? Isn't that what happens to some people?
Is there anyone living here that I don't know about? There, in the broad sunlight, I saw the other one.
There are two of them. Abominations.
How did Miss Jessel die?
She put an end to herself. She was found in the lake.
What shall I say when his feet enter softly, leaving the marks of his grave on my floor?
Hey, Joe, drag your foot, boy. Look what we got here. Hey, you want to drag, huh? Come on. See that telephone pole? We'll take you to it, yeah.
Come, if you dare, within these walls. On stage is color, beauty, and light. But in the shadows lurks a monstrous evil.
Young woman, you must come with me.
Terror haunts these dusty corridors. Murder waits its call in the dressing rooms. And on cue, death makes his entrance. No right to love and happiness, for this beautiful young girl is tangled in a web of terror. The Phantom of the Opera. The hideous echo of a night of agony and horror. A night that must be avenged even from beyond the grave.
Ghosts.
This is the night when fear and horror walk hand in hand.
This is Black Sabbath.
Starring the incomparable Boris Karloff, the personable Mark Damon, and lush and lovely women, even though one is from the netherworld, a vampire, a Vordalak. Black Sabbath, as ancient a superstition, as modern as the telephone.
How nice you look with that towel around you. You always did have a beautiful body. Beautiful. A body to drive someone crazy.
Why, who are you? Who?
Black Sabbath. The bare truth about the unbelievable, such as the brilliant beauty of a priceless jewel that holds within the body of a buzzing fly, a vengeful woman's murderous spirit. Only on the seventh night of the seventh full moon can the living see the lifeless undead.
I am hungry.
Is he man? Or vampire? An adventure into black magic that goes beyond the boundaries of the supernatural. And a man's devoted love is welcomed by a woman's deadly lust for his blood.
The supernatural is something that isn't supposed to happen, but it does happen.
Now look, Doc, we're buddies, okay? But don't try to convert me.
I'm trying to prepare you. My name's Marquay, Dr. Marquay, a scientist interested in the supernatural. The unnatural, if you like. I came to Hill House to find the key to another world. Assisting me in this exploration of the unknown was Eleanor, Nell, who could look back into the past, and Theo, something of a witch who could see into the future. This is Luke, who didn't believe in anything. Until evil, patient and waiting, made him change his mind.
Stop it! God. God. Whose hand was I holding?
How many of us take seriously the things we cannot or do not want to understand simply because we are afraid?
Eleanor, you're poor! Did you hear me calling?
This house. You have to watch it every minute.
The Haunting was produced and directed by Robert Wise, brilliant producer of West Side Story. The stars consist of a cross-section of top talent in the world of entertainment. Julie Harris, Claire Bloom, Richard Johnson, Russ Tamblyn. What does it take to convince you that the dead do not always rest in peace? That some houses, like Hill House, are born bad?
Castle of Blood. This is the shocking drama of a young writer who disregards the warning of his master, Edgar Allan Poe, and accepts a wager to pass the night in a castle of mystery and legend. The Castle of Blood. No one has ever witnessed and survived the awesome secrets, the ghostly events of this castle of the damned.
I've dreamed of this night. At last I can go away with the man I love.
You can't leave, Elizabeth. You're trapped in this castle.
Here the dead rise from their tombs once a year to repeat their hideous crimes of murder and passion.
Kiss me. Yes, my dearest. Keep on embracing me, the one to absorb the warmth of your body.
For a moment, I thought that your heart had stopped.
I'm dead, Alan.
No! No, Herbert, no! No!
Every death is repeated tonight. Come.
No, Elizabeth.
Edgar Allan Poe's most gripping, chilling drama of horror and suspense. Castle of Blood.
This room.
This man's name is John Austin Fraser. He lived in Chicago, Illinois. He now resides at the State Mental Hospital. We are saddened to tell you that this tragic condition was brought on when Mr. Fraser attended the world premiere of our triple nightmare of horror program, Orgy of the Living Dead. Since this tragic event, the producers of the program have secured an insurance policy, ensuring the sanity of each and every patron. The policy states that in the event you lose your mind as a result of viewing this explosion of terror, you will be provided with free internment in an asylum for the rest of your natural life. Poor John. It's not surprising, though, after all. Murder, mutilation, blood-sucking vampires, living dead maniacs slashing, rending, devouring the living. It's enough to drive anyone mad. Be sure you're insured before you dare to see Revenge of the Living Dead, Curse of the Living Dead, and Fangs of the Living Dead.
Coach is bound for a terrifying destination. Dead. But no corpse can remain at peace in this village of the undead, this land of the zombies. In this place, no one is safe. No one can hide from witchcraft, superstition, and fear. No! Even Sir James Forbes, the clear-headed man of science, was forced to accept the horrifying facts.
Young Martinus also says that he saw something on the moors, something that he insists was his brother. But we know that his brother is dead. We also know that he is not lying in his coffin. Someone in this village is practicing witchcraft. That corpse wandering on the moors is an undead, a zombie.
A place dominated by men without morals, whose bloodlusts are excited by hunting a human quarry. When Sylvia Forbes hated the young squire, it was dangerous. But when she fell in love with him, it was lethal.
По мотивам одноименной повести Николая Гоголя «Винь». Сценарий и постановка под руководством известного режиссера Александра Птушко. В фильме «Винь» Наталья Варлей и Леонид Куравлев.
Ведьма! Ей-богу, ведьма!
Haunted souls hunt the living whose bodies are the only food for these ungodly creatures. Night.
adventure in fear. An experience in shock, more shattering than your strangest nightmare. Night of the Living Dead. A night with the dead who cannot die. A night of total terror. Night. Of the Living Dead.
Oh, it's a wonderful apartment. I love it.
See, what she's trying to do, she's trying to get you lower the rent.
Let's have a baby, all right? Let's have three babies, one at a time, all right?
You really mean it, really?
No, I'm kidding. Sure I mean it.
Are you aware that the Bramford had rather an unpleasant reputation around the turn of the century?
Awful things happen in every apartment house.
This house has a high incidence of unpleasant happenings.
This is for you from Roman and me. Just a little present is all for moving in.
We have to make a baby.
You all right?
I have a pain.
Where?
Here. Wire inside me getting tighter and tighter.
Sleep is what you need. Good night's sleep.
Where's the baby? Where is it?
We're your friends, Rosemary.
I don't believe you. You're lying. Monsters.
Time.
Ben, don't talk that way.
Watch it, young lady. Careful, sir. Keep your head down or I'll tap you on the chin. Look out. Duck.
Immensely strong and destructive. A woman's beauty, the bait that brought it out of its lair.
TripAdvisor calls us one of the top 10 ghost tours in the U.S. for good reason. Not only are our guides the best storytellers in the business, several attract a lot of things themselves. Book your tour now at ChattanoogaGhostTours.com. Chattanooga Ghost Tours offers not only award-winning tours, we are the first ghost tour in the world to offer investigations and ghost hunts using amazing tools such as the Talking Ophelus and the new Ultimate Hunt with SLS Ghost Mapping.
Show yourself again?
Yes.
Book now.
Like the 80s? Do you like heavy metal? Do you like the dark side? Then you need to add some Trace to your spooky season with the Trace book series by Mandy L. Contrell. It all began with Trace and the Devil. It's 1988 at Fairview High School, and bad boy Trace has found the girl of his dreams. Will she love him in return? Despite his dark connections, how far will he go for love? This first Trace book and the second and third are all available on Amazon and in select stores. These books are being compared to The Twilight Zone, Tales from the Crypt, Tales from the Dark Side, and Creepshow. So follow Trace if you dare. And welcome back to another episode of Dollar Store Drive-In. I'm your host, Laura.
I'm Joel.
And we are the Newly Dads. And if this is your first time watching or listening, if you're on Spotify, this is a half-hour chat show where we talk about a movie that we watched. And we've got a couple of pieces of criteria.
It needs to be under $5. It needs to be a horror-themed related or sci-fi genre thriller type of movie. It needs to be typically found in the wild, but sometimes we rent it. Sometimes it's given to us. And it needs to be a movie we've never seen before.
Nailed it.
And also, if this is 6 o'clock or 6:30-ish on a Wednesday night, you can usually find us in the chat on TinglerTelevision.com. So, right?
Or the YouTube, Tingler Television channel, because it's going to be correlated at some point, but right now it's all up in the air. Things are still a little messy. So check the YouTube channel. But if you're on our Facebook page and you're subscribed or you like it, follow us. I put updates there every week on Tuesday, typically, so that you know what to expect. And that way you can be there. But if you're not sure, send us a message or email us at contact@thenewlyeds.com, and I will do my best to find out for you exactly what's going on. But if you get to the YouTube channel and the show is already over, you can just hit the old rewind button and back it up and watch it. And if we're there, you can watch it with us.
Exactly. And if you are interested in finding out more about the Newly Deads, I'm just going to do that in the beginning of the show here.
Why not?
You can check out our website, which is thenewlydeads.com. We create art, and we also are writers, I guess, because we do have a blog. We also do the show. So, and sometimes you can find us live and in person. So we have an event coming up at the end of May at Wolf Hollow in Rockford, Illinois. It's going to be the Summerween event where we are going to be selling some fun things. Could you put some of our sticker designs up? We have, yeah. So we've got some one-of-a-kind stickers this year that we are selling for 2024. So it's the Summerween 2024 exclusive
only
stickers only
available
this year at Summerween. So
where you can meet us, get if you want to get an autograph, if you want to tell us a story, if you want to hug us, some
high five,
I suppose.
Sometimes we like doing bumps. This.
We like doing
that.
Thumbs up. We can do Smashing Pumpkins.
Yeah, we have pumpkin tattoos on our hands, so we can smash a little pumpkin.
There's lots of stuff. Also, you can also check out our YouTube channel if you're not on YouTube right now. And there's lots of other content. We put out stuff 6 days a week, new content of some form or another.
Yeah, whether it's written form,
podcast videos,
all
snack
sorts
reviews,
of fun things,
unboxings,
and this
coffee
is
reviews.
Just a hobby, people.
This is not our full time job.
We
do not
paid
get paid
for any
for
this. Of
this. This is all free.
Just a hobby.
We actually spend money to do this.
Yeah. So.
But we love it. And
we do.
Who knows? Maybe someday it'll be a full-time job. But right now, it's just perfect.
Yes. So hopefully you'll check it out. Share it with your friends. Share it with your family. Share it with your enemies.
Share it with your dogs.
Share it with your dogs.
We're a dog-friendly channel, if you haven't noticed. If you've been here before, you'll see our dogs.
Yes.
Right now, they're out of sight, but they're always lurking. So.
Yep. All right. Well, let's get on to the movie. Get on down. And burrow on down.
Oh no, she said the name of the movie.
The Burrowers is what we watched this week. Evil will surface. Joel, what?
Is the creature on the back?
No.
Oh, I thought I saw a little face.
No. There's someone buried.
Oh.
Yeah. So Joel said when he picked this out, well, he usually does a random he does a random spin, right?
Yes.
To try to figure out what we're going to be watching.
Yes.
And so when he picked us out of the pile, he was very excited because he said he's had this on his to watch list for a long time.
Because this movie came out in
2008.
And somewhere around 8, 10, somewhere in there, I heard about it and was like, oh, I kind of want to watch that. Sounds interesting. And
yeah. It's a horror Western.
Didn't see it until now.
Yeah. So I'm going to read the back of the, synopsis here for you. It's a splendid blend of raw Western grit and unnerving horror. That's just the twitch.com review.
Oh,
you
I
thought
was
I was starting.
Started to,
I know I could see you doing your little like
mining.
He has a tendency to start, doing his little thing. Anyways, now we can start. The Dakota Territories, 1879. a handful of brave pioneers maintain isolated settlements in the Badlands beyond civilization. Irish immigrant Fergus Coffey is near to winning the hand of his beloved Mary Ann when she is suddenly taken from him, her family brutally abducted in a nighttime attack on their homestead. Suspicion falls immediately on hostile Indians. Experienced Indian fighters Will Parcher and John Clay form a posse and set out to rescue the kidnapped settlers, taking along naive teenager hoping to prove himself a man, an ex-slave looking for his place, and their ranch hand, Coffee. But as men vanish in the night and horrific evidence accumulates with the dead and dying, the group discovers that their prey is far more terrifying than anything human, and their prospects are far more terrible than death. Yeah. So
that was a lot.
That was a lot. There is a lot of special features on this also that we subsequently watched.
There's a couple of featurettes.
No, it's like the making of the horror western, digging up the burrowers.
5 minutes.
Commentary.
Didn't watch that. And there was a bunch of trailers that we skipped through.
That's true.
Because we already had seen most of the movies, but
yeah.
It does, because it's not like one that you'd find typically at the Dollar Tree that, you know, doesn't have anything on it. It's just $1.25. So it actually has extra features on it. It's special.
Yeah. Okay. So.
Uh-oh.
Should we watch the trailer?
No. All right.
Yeah. So in order to let the viewers in on the.
You mean the listeners?
The glory. And the listeners.
Oh, I thought you were explaining how the trailer works.
No. I was just, you know, like, if you want to, you know, like, watch the glory of the burrowers. Yes. We're going to watch the trailer.
You can rent it.
Yeah.
Or buy it.
The trailer is right here.
Oh, wow. That was
fast. It's a wagon trailer.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Probably came up out of the ground.
From 1879.
Because it was burrowing.
You know, it's from 1879.
So it doesn't honk then.
No. It creaks. Like. You know?
Giddy up, little doggy.
Yeah. All right. We'll be right back.
Indians. They killed. They took Marianne. Took the whole family.
What kind of weapon makes a wound like that?
We'll find them. We don't quit. We don't sleep.
It's like you found yourself a hole in the ground there, Will. What do you think, cowboy?
I don't know. Another right there.
This is something we ain't seen before.
Who takes men and horses and leaves the valuables to rot?
Woke up.
He says another tribe, miners.
He didn't say miners. He used the word for when animals dig, burrow maybe.
Why would they bury her alive? I don't know.
Once you get to Fort Lincoln, you stay with her. We'll pick you up on our way back.
We're back. Joel's still riding a horse.
I forgot that I was riding the horse.
Yep.
I made Shaggy move because of that. That's our dog. He's down there. Anyway.
Anyways, so you got some things to read.
Oh yeah, I forgot. I gotta grab my notes, don't I? I'm a little out of sorts. It's been a long day.
Senior, newly dead.
Senior me. All right. So whenever I write notes about the movie we're watching, I always will draw some pictures in there just for fun. Sometimes it distracts me from the film. In this case, I should have paid more attention. Maybe, who knows? We'll find out. But anyway, so I drew a sad little robot guy. He's actually kind of surly, little robot guy. And then this guy, that's a dead burrowing creature. And then this guy that's confused.
He's confused.
Because he's confused about things. This is dead scene.
What's a graboid?
From Tremors.
I should have known that.
I love Tremors, by the way.
That's yeah.
A thing. Anyway, so The Burrowers is from 2008, as we just said right before the break. It's currently sitting at 5.7 out of 10 on the Internet Movie Database. So for a dollar store drive-in film, this is like Academy Award level of... Ours range between the low like twos to ones to threes and fours on average.
Yeah.
So nearly a six is like pretty high up there.
Yeah.
All right. This is directed and written by J.T. Petty, who, when we watched the special features, he was interviewed. He is known for Hellbenders, is another Clancy Brown film that also has that guy that I can see his face, but I can't call his name right now. But you know him if you saw him. He's always got funky hair. Anyway, he's in S and Man.
Like Sandman?
Like S and then the plus symbol Man. Not Saint Man, but like, or maybe it's Five and Man.
Or Sandman.
I don't know. It's weird. I just remember I wrote it down. I'm like, I need to remember that was weird and what that was. And now I'm looking at it.
Sandman.
Might be Sandman. I'll put it in here. You'll see. And Mimic Sentinel, which was one of the sequels to the original Guillermo del Toro Mimic film about the giant cockroaches battling Mina Sorvino in the sewers of New York, I believe. Great film. If you've never seen it, loved it. But he also wrote all those films, and he's done a lot of stuff with video games. That's our hero. So this stars one Clancy Brown, who you may know as Mr. Krabs from SpongeBob SquarePants.
You always say. He's in a whole bunch of other things.
But I named two favorites of mine of his filmography, which are Starship Troopers. Comes up on the show a lot. Not just because I love it, but because it's a lot of actors we watch. And The Shawshank Redemption. He was in that as well. Mm. I'm going to mention this, although I didn't write it down, because I know if I don't, my friends and former podcast colleagues will be upset. He was also in Highlander as Kurgan. So there you go. You're welcome, guys. This also stars one Doug Hutchinson, the guy that plays a-holes with vigor.
Yeah, he was in The Green Mile.
That's the first one on the list, The Green Mile, where he is just an awful human being that deserved everything he got.
Yep.
He was in The Punisher Warzone, which... for me, is the best version of The Punisher so far, although I admittedly have somehow not gotten to The Punisher series on Netflix yet. But Warzone features Ray Stevenson, and he is brilliant, and that character, he was built to play that role. Perfect. Anyway, and he was in I Am Sam. Remember that movie?
Yeah.
With Sean Penn?
Yeah.
Yeah. It kind of went along with the other sister, like they're around the same time. I don't know if they would hold up well anymore. But at the time, they were like this big thing. Like, they were like, Academy Award.
Right.
Should get an Academy. I don't know. I haven't seen them in a long time. But I Am Sam, it's on the shelf, I believe, as is Punisher Warzone and The Green Mile and Shawshank Redemption and Starship Troopers. So all of these are on the shelf. And finally, the last person I want to mention here is William Mapother, who you know his face. You've seen him in 100 things. He was in Magnolia, which Paul Thomas Anderson, chef's kiss, on the shelf. He was in Mission Impossible 2. The John Woo sequel to the franchise that just keeps getting better somehow. I don't know how that's possible. That's on the shelf also. And he was in Swordfish, which, not on the shelf. Doesn't ever need to be on the shelf. Hmm. Have you ever seen Swordfish?
Mm-mm.
With John Travolta?
I know what you're talking about.
And Halle Berry. But there's a through line here. Because Magnolia and Mission Impossible, not Swordfish so much, they both star one Tom Cruise. Mm-hmm. And the reason I bring that up is because William Mapother is in a lot of Tom Cruise films for one reason. It's his cousin.
Oh.
Trivia.
Oh, yeah. You said you had some trivia for me.
Yep.
I like trivia. Cousin.
So if you look at him, you're kind of like, oh, I can kind of see the Scientology resemblance. Kind of. But they're cousins, yeah. So anyway, at this point, my wife turns to me and says,
what'd you think?
And I always usually will say something along the lines of, I got thoughts. We got things to talk about. So the first thing that I noticed as soon as this movie started is that it started out, I felt like the very first like 2 minutes was a little weird.
Yeah, like he was just like screaming, Marianne, Marianne.
Well, even before that, he's like, gonna propose to her and yeah, like out in a field and there's like these long like
he gave her a brooch
shots of them, you know, with the wheat and the wind and they're that the audio seems a little out of sync, like it's a dream.
It was out of sync. It was weird.
Yeah, it was very like Hallmark Channel, like I'm not dissing Little House on the Prairie because it's a thing. I love Little House on the Prairie. I even own a piece of Laura Ingalls Wilder's original home. I'm weird about it. I don't know if she knows all that, but
I did not.
It's a thing. Anyway, it reminded me of like a Little House on the Prairie kind of riff. But the soon as that ended and it got into the actual movie, I was like, okay, we're dealing with a real movie. Because I was like, oh no, it's like a made for TV thing and it's going to be awful. But it turned into very much a real movie. I have to say it's definitely an interesting premise. It does reek of Tremors. But once you see the creatures and what they do, you're like, nope, this is not Tremors.
No.
Not at all. Because I forget, have you seen Tremors?
Yeah.
I know we've talked about it a long
time ago. Yeah.
You've not seen it like me, right? Just it's a thing where like I have multiple versions of it on the shelf.
No.
And big box sets of it and things like that. No. Okay. So yeah, it's definitely. And the other thing that I noticed here is that I wasn't writing any notes down. I wasn't drawing any pictures for a while, and I had to like force myself to do it because I was a little too invested in the movie.
Yeah, you liked it.
A little too invested in the movie. Talking on the side of my mouth because that's what I'm invested. I don't know. No, I don't know. I even wrote it feels like a serious tremor, and I wrote not a graboid because I learned pretty early on that they were definitely not graboids. It's kind of a slow burn, but it's very engaging.
Yeah,
like, I didn't want to take my eyes off the screen. I also felt like I wasn't sure what the rewatchability would be. Like when you don't know what's going on, it's very engaging. But I wonder if now that we've seen it, if we would be like, oh, I want to watch that again. And was it just me or did the ending feel a little bit like Night of the Living Dead? Not that there's zombies, but like the way that it ended felt a little like the original Night of the Living Dead. I should have brought this up before we started filming.
I don't know. We kind of talked about the ending a little bit.
Well, yeah. And we'll get to the ending here soon. But I just thought of it because I was like, you know, this reminded me actually a little bit of Night of the Living Dead, the way it ended. Incidentally, the creatures make a sound.
That I did not like.
And I wrote here, Laura loves it because I was being incredibly sarcastic. Because every time it came on, she got very like, she did not like it. It's like me with like chewing on tinfoil or styrofoam.
I have like
she doesn't like it.
I have misophonia and it was bothering me.
Yeah, she was very
it was apparent. Sending like this like chill up my like spine and like I didn't like it. Ugh, it was like a clicky kind of noise. Yeah,
I don't know if it's probably in the trailer and I don't
it's
know
like the
I'll
grudge
out
you know
in,
kind of noise.
Yeah, kind of
where she's like that noise, you know. But it's like in the same clicky. It's in the same family. It's in the same family as
it's
that.
All in the family.
Yeah, that noise just bothers my misophonia.
It set her teeth on edge. So
yeah.
I have more notes, but I know you have notes. So what have there any notes you want to touch on?
I said I hate horse killers and sadistic a-hole white people who torture indigenous people.
Yeah, there was a lot of
lot of that.
There was a lot of racism throughout the film, but I mean I think they were trying to set the tone for how it ended. With the fact that at that point in time in the U.S. and I mean, not that it's gone today by any stretch, but at that point it was.
I mean, it's not that bad now.
No, it's not as bad as it was then. But I mean, they were trying to kind of nail the point home that things were very different then, and people believed and got away with a lot worse things than. And again, there's bad crap today, but it was different time. I mean, there was a lot of animals that were killed in that. Like an unusual amount of animals and children.
Yeah.
Very weird.
Yeah.
Sorry, so, go ahead.
That was my thing. Like I wrote old scratchy toe.
And that part was good. Like,
yeah.
There's in the opening scene, there's a family where their neighbor, you know, in the Old West, their neighbor is like a mile away, shows up and is like, hey, you know, so-and-so is missing. You guys go down to the cellar and don't make a sound and keep your light low. And you hear the scratching on the floor and the walls above them. And you can see, you know, because they've got slats with spaces between. Cause it's, you know, it's a house you built on your own in the middle of nowhere. And you can hear it clawing and scratching as it's walking and kind of looking. And it's pretty intense. It's good. What did you draw something?
I drew this little piggy wiggled a lot.
Oh, yeah. The thing.
That's what I was talking about, the old scratchy toe.
Oh, I thought it was because they were.
No, because like there was a girl that was like buried alive and like she was still alive. She was like, you could see her eye moving. And then like there was something moving in her boot and like they took her shoe off and her toe was like scratching in her boot.
Yeah, like her like, so I don't want to give too much away in case you see it, but the creatures bury people and they paralyze them. And I wrote here because of the way that they're not there all the time. They show up every, so I forget how long.
They're like cicadas.
Yeah, kind of like it was a mix between like, what did you say they look like?
I said ants? That they're like ants, I wrote big ass ancient ants, but vampires.
And I wrote vampire ants, which mm-hmm. is a band name. Not, I don't want it. You can have it. But it was kind of like Jeepers Creepers, but underground and soft parts is what I wrote.
Oh, they like the soft parts.
Yeah. And so.
And one guy said, but I like my soft parts.
So the people that, are still cognizant of what's going on. They just can't do anything about it because they're paralyzed. Poisoned.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's why she was only able to move like her toes and occasionally her eye would kind of twitch. They also kind of reminded me of the Lickers from Resident Evil, just the design, not the way that they moved or that they had a tongue or that they were, you know, super strong or anything like that. Just kind of the basic character.
Yeah, it's like a
creature design.
Potato with legs.
Kinda, yeah. And they did definitely look a little like ants. Have you ever seen like a super like microscopic close-up view of an ant's face? It's terrible.
Well,
it's
from what I understand, don't ants paralyze their like, you know, their things? I'm pretty sure they kept sounds showing right. ants like
they did.
On things, and I was like, I'm getting the vibe that they're like wanting you to. And ants are underground. They burrow underground. Sure. I think that they were trying to get you to get the vibe that these creatures are supposed to be like, I don't know.
They are pretty strong.
Ant-like. I mean, like,
you know, they pull people
mm-hmm.
across the ground and they burrow really, really fast into the yeah. earth.
They're like ant-like.
So yeah, I would see that. Not like Ant-Man, but
they don't have like pinchers or like ant faces or anything.
They've got like appendages with like little claws on them that are almost like hands, and then they've got back like legs that are bent the wrong way, kind of like goat leg sort of things. Yeah,
like a cricket.
Kind of yeah, like a if you that like a grasshopper or a cricket. They even have a grasshopper in one of the shots, I think.
Yeah.
So and then the last thing I wrote was the ending. Yes or no. So without giving it away, because I do recommend you watch this film. If this sounds interesting to you at all, you want to see a horror Western, which there's not a lot of them out there. Tremors, the Return to Paradise is set in an old West town. And that's not really a horror movie. It's more of a horror comedy. But that one's one of the few that, and it would kind of tie in with this, but it's not the one I picked, by the way, because it is way too funny to be tied in with this.
Yeah.
So anyway, without giving away the ending, did you feel that the ending was appropriate? Did you like the ending? Did you not like it?
I said it's kind of a shit ending.
Whoa, you cursed. I have to bleep that out. Yeah, I'm going to bleep that out too. Stop it. She's making it hard on me.
Poop ending.
The only thing we say is dick. We say dick a lot on there. But anyway. Like Richard, you know, like Richard Nixon. He's Dick Nixon.
You can say shit.
Or Dick Dixter. Now I got to bleep that out too.
You don't have to bleep
that.
Stop bleeping me.
You don't have to control over it.
Don't bleep me.
I didn't like the ending when it happened. The more I thought about it, like I said, it kind of feels like Night of the Living Dead to me a little bit. which that ending was more effective, I think. I think they were trying too hard because they hit too many things at the end that they're like, hey, we're going to be like, message, 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 message. And it felt a little...
I felt ripped off.
You did? Here's the thing. I was really enjoying this film. And I if you haven't already got that, our dog is dreaming right now and he's wagging his tail.
Mm-hmm.
I really like this movie up to the very end. And then I kind of went, okay, you kind of cashed out a little too early. But I get what they were going for. So I don't hate it because of that. But I feel like they could have done something a little different. It would have been more fun.
I was mad.
Yeah. But that's okay. Because I think it was kind of like Doug Hutchinson's character, where you're supposed to be upset. Were you upset at the situation or just that it ended the way it ended? Like, that it was kind of an abrupt ending.
I was just mad the way that it ended.
Not that it was abrupt?
No.
Okay. So see, then it accomplished what it was set out to do, I think. It was, you know, like, and don't be a message, don't be a menace to South Central while drinking your juice in the hood. Message! You know, I'll put the little gift down here for all of you anyway. Okay. So.
Flute mouth.
I think I'm done.
All right, so on a scale of one, or well, I guess a zero to five toes, pinky toes.
Incidentally, if you want to read my short reviews and see what we're watching, you can check me out on Letterboxd, or you can read my blog, Cinematorium, that is on our website. And I do longer reviews of a lot of these films. Not all of them, but a lot of them.
How do they find your Letterboxd? What's it under?
I don't remember. I'll have to find that out and put it on somewhere. But anyway, it is. I'm giving it a 3.
Oh, that's pretty good for you.
I don't love it.
I did not fall asleep during it.
She did not. She was awake the whole time, and it was a slow burn. Even
I am pretty tired right now.
She is pretty tired right now.
Yawned a couple times.
She did yawn a couple times.
Sorry about that.
I was too busy talking.
I know. I'm sorry. I would give it a. I'd give it a 2.5.
2.5. All right. Fair enough.
Because I like Clancy.
Well, yeah.
And I like the Irish guy. And I liked...
You liked most of the cast.
Callahan, that guy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I like that guy. So, okay. So if they don't want to watch this movie...
Or if you want to pair it with another film.
Or if you want to pair it with another film, or if you just want a different suggestion, what should they watch?
As I said before, Return to Paradise, the Tremors film, if you want a light version of this, is a fine film to watch, but it didn't feel like the right thing to pair up or to compare this to. So I'm going with 2015's Craig S. Zahler's Bone Tomahawk, which I don't recommend this film if you have a weak stomach. If you really like Kurt Russell, or if you just don't want to be disturbed, because you will feel bad for Kurt, you'll be disturbed and disgusted at the same time, and probably be grossed out. But it's a really well done. Craig S. Zahler is one of my favorite current filmmakers. The guy just does amazingly well written and lots of effects. But they're not horror movies all the time. They're like, a lot of times they're crime dramas, but there's just like over the top blood, guts, gore, Nicky stuff. Yeah. And this one is...
Blood, guts, gore, Nicky stuff.
Is about a group of guys in the Old West that are out trying to rescue somebody else. And it turns out that they've been taken by a group of cannibals that are living in the mountains. It's kind of like The Hills Have Eyes meets Tombstone. And they do not hold back on the cannibalism.
Oh.
At all.
Oh.
At all.
Oh.
It is disturbing, some of the stuff that they do in there. If you've ever seen any of the videos that you probably shouldn't see on TV about awful things being done to other people, it feels like one of those, but just special effects. Oh, and Sid Haig's in it, very briefly.
Really?
Mm-hmm. But anyway, it's a great film. It's on the shelf.
I don't think I could watch it.
I have all
that.
Of Craig S. Zahler's films. I love them all.
All right. What are we watching next week?
Oh, yeah. Because we're running out of time. Next week, we are watching... Are you putting that down gently?
I did.
Or is it blowing up?
I gently put it down.
Okay.
You like it, didn't you?
Yeah.
I just put it on the shelf?
No. I just didn't know if I needed to blow it up or not because I couldn't tell.
We are watching the movie Only.
From 2019.
Brita Pinto is in this, and so is Leslie Odom Jr.
And one more.
Someone named only.
Nope. Look at the back.
Oh, cool. Coral's in it.
Yep. Chandler Riggs.
Cool.
2019. So this is after, I believe, after he left The Walking Dead.
Yeah, you're supposed to say he looks like a grown-up.
But yeah, Leslie Odom Jr. from Hamilton fame, Frida Pinto from a ton of stuff, and Chandler Riggs. Yeah, so.
All right. So Eva might be the only woman left on Earth after a mysterious plague threatens to kill all females on the planet. The lives and relationship of Eva, which is Frida Pinto, and Will, Leslie Odom Jr., are put to the ultimate test as they try to survive the disease and the dangerous people hunting her down. Oh, that could seem very rapey.
I don't know. I hope not, because I like the premise, but I don't want any of that.
He looks like he's going to shoot somebody.
He does. He looks very, like, aggro. It could just be teen angst, for all we know. Maybe he's got a broom and he's like, I'm not cleaning anymore, Mom! I don't know.
That is very interesting.
I when I pulled that out on the draw, when I, you know, we do everything random, I was kind of excited because I'm like, this sounds like it might keep us.
Yeah, it's like a zombie apocalypse kind of thing, but no zombies.
Right.
Just lots of. Oh, it's more like. Kind of reminds me of. Oh gosh, why can't I think of it? The Handmaid's Tale.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, like where, you know, they can't, like some people can't have babies kind of a thing. And so, like, yeah, that's what it kind of reminds me of.
Don't want to have too many babies. There's a lot of fat of them. They're high in cholesterol. But I'm thinking that if the box looks good enough that I think it might.
Yeah.
We might have a streak going. Who knows?
Interesting.
And if that's the case, can we make it a full month, full four movies that are all good?
That are like, you know, above a two?
This is a challenge. Accepted.
Yes.
We've already given all of our socials, so I think we're done.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed this episode of the Newly Dead's Watch Dollar Store Drive-In. thanks very much for watching, and until next week.
Keep it cheap and creepy.
Bye.
Where are you going?
We gotta finish this.